Water is a living organism. Water is sacred. Water is life. Water is worth defending and protecting for those yet unborn. Rivers and lakes in Alberta don't stop at provincial borders. These rivers and lakes flow throughout Canada and the United States. Therefore, everyone will be impacted by the omnibus bills which have become law. This means the previous 2.5 million lakes and rivers that were protected on December 4, 2012, have been diminished to only 62 protected rivers and 97 lakes. If you enjoy the benefits of the Canadian outdoors, camping, canoeing, boating, fishing for that matter, clean drinking water, we need to ask ourselves, how will we be impacted by the sale of our water resources? Essentially, global corporation is dictating that the Canadian federal government abolish treaties and then assimilate First Nations peoples into urban cities. Why? Treaties stand in the way of the federal government. Traditional treaty territories within Canada protect our natural resources, and within these traditional territories, the four-legged, the winged, and those within the waters, all our relations will no longer be protected, as well as our human rights.
This bill, C-45, this is a genocide on the environment. To kill off the water, the environment, the animals. What are the moose, the deer, the buffalo, the bear? You know, the bear is made like its skeleton is like a human. That's why he's called Montoisian. And we have a song for him. What is he going to drink? You know, where is he going to build his den? And we honor these grandpas, the eagles, when they go and nest up north, you know? Where are they going to build their nests up in those big, tall, magnificent trees? The fish, those are our big brothers too. We have songs for the fish. And we honor the fish. Yugumina, you know, he's going to get sick. There's a reason why there's fish. There's a reason why there's a beaver. When a beaver builds a house, you know? He builds a dam. There's a reason why for all of those. There'll come a day, they said. I think it was the 13th prophecy, where you won't be able to drink your water from your tap.
The government has cut $186 million from the First Nation Water and Wastewater Action Plan and sunsetted the entire program. Last year, the Auditor General roundly criticized this government for ignoring her decade of calls for greater investment to provide First Nations with the basic services other Canadians have become used to. Can the government explain how cutting the water program addresses the Governor General's calls for expedited action into drinking water, including to the more than 100 communities still suffering under...
In December, at the end of the Mayan calendar, there's a sense that there is something manifesting this movement, this revolution to begin to really protect the earth and talk in unison, not just indigenous people, but non-indigenous people all through the world. So today it's different. It is different because there is people, especially the women that are taking control, taking back their authority. And the young people, the young generation that are standing up. So this movement, this Idle No More movement, is is real. Just like climate change is real. It's happening. And people need to get ready. People need to prepare themselves for what is to come. But now there is thousands of voices calling out, standing up, dancing, singing, laughing, and the elders, the women, the children coming together and saying, protect the environment.
My name is Melina Labocan-Massimo. I come from the community of Little Buffalo, and I'm a member of the Lubicon Cree First Nation. I'm also a climate and energy campaigner with Greenpeace Canada. The traditional territory of the Lubicon Cree covers approximately 10,000 square kilometers of low-lying trees, forests, rivers, plains, wetlands, what we call muskeg, and it's in northern Alberta. My community has dealt with 3 decades of massive oil and gas development, and this has been without the consent of the people or without the recognition or protection of the human rights, which should be protected under Section 35 of the Canadian Constitution, which protects Aboriginal and treaty rights. In the 70s, before this type of encroachment on the land and development happened, my father's generation was living sustenance living with my grandparents, where they actually hunted and fished and trapped throughout the region, throughout the traditional territory. Back then, and you know, even into my generation, I remember going on the trap line and going out in the horse and wagon. People were still living off the land, the water still was good to drink, but as oil and gas came through the territory, it's changed a lot. Currently, there's more than 2,600 oil and gas wells in our traditional territories. 1,400 square kilometers of leases have been granted for in-situ oil sands development in Lubicon territory, and almost 70% of Lubicon territory has been leased for future development. So what we see is an Indigenous way of life being overshadowed by intensive oil and gas development. We see, you know, where there once was self-sufficiency in the communities, in the region, you know, because there was clean air, clean water, medicines, berries, and plants from the boreal. We see this changing, you know, with an increased dependency on social services because families are not able to sustain themselves in what was once a healthy environment. And what else we also see is health concerns, respiratory illnesses because of the noxious gases that are being released into the air and water. We see in the north elevated rates of cancers, and then also lack of medical services. And it's been calculated that almost $14 billion has been taken out of our traditional territory in revenue for the oil and gas company, and yet the resources don't go back into the community. And this is very much, you know, a symptomatic problem that we see happening in a lot of Indigenous communities across Canada, where, you know, these are like one of the few last pristine ecosystems that are still living in Canada, and yet the communities have to deal with the repercussions of contamination. And what we see our way of life being replaced by is industrial landscapes, polluted and drained watersheds, and contaminated air. So it's very much a crisis situation. On April 29th, 2011, there was a rupture in the Rainbow Pipeline, which resulted in a massive oil spill by our community. It was about 4.5 million liters. It was one of the biggest oil spills in Alberta's history. What happened is the pipeline broke and leaked, and this oil went down the corridor and also into the forest, but majority of it got soaked up into the muskeg, which is like peatland moss, which takes thousands of years to be generated. And this is an issue because the muskeg is connected to all the water there. It's not just an isolated system. It's not, quote, stagnant water that the government tries to say that it is. It's actually a living, breathing ecosystem that supports life. So the first day of the spill, the school actually didn't even know that there was an oil spill. So when the kids came to school that day, when people started feeling sick, they actually took the students outside of the school because they thought it was a propane leak. And when they got outside into the field, the principal said it was just as bad. They realized that it was all over in the community. It wasn't just inside the school. So they were very concerned and didn't receive the information that they should have. It took 5 days for the community to officially know the immensity of the spill. The school had to be shut down in the community for almost a week and a half. The first week of the spill, community members were getting sick, their eyes were burning, people had headaches, people were feeling nauseous. Supposedly the air quality issues weren't a problem, even though Alberta Environment didn't actually come onto site into the community until 6 days after the spill. And this is very problematic, because if a community is complaining about being sick, then the government who's giving these permits and allowing this type of development to even happen, which is without the consent of the people in the community a lot of the times, needs to take care of the people that, you know, it's putting, they're at direct risk. A lot of people were left wondering what they should be doing, left wondering if they should be even in the community, you know, if pregnant women should be in the community, if small children. It's a 45-year-old pipeline, and who knows what will happen in the future for other communities along this corridor. When the pipeline broke in 2006, and the EUB at the time had stated that there was stress and corrosion factors related to the pipeline's infrastructure, you know, 1 million liters were spilt. And now we see 5 years later, 4.5 million liters spilt in our traditional territory. When does it ever end? When does it ever stop? Communities are going to have to be on watch because of pipeline breaks like this, and we're seeing pipeline breaks all over North America. We saw it in Kalamazoo with the Michigan spill, which was 3 million liters. We saw it, you know, in other parts with the Kinder Morgan pipeline going to the West Coast. We saw a spill there. So people are very concerned. The UN has actually put forward recommendations regarding moratoriums on oil and gas in Lubicon territory. On March 26th of 1990, the United Nations Human Rights Committee actually ruled that the failure to recognize and protect Lubicon lands has led to the ongoing threat of our way of life and culture. And also again in 2005, the United Nations Human Rights Committee cited Canada for violating the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights in regards to the treatment of the Lubicon. So this is being documented by a variety of human rights committees, and yet we still see this type of development happening. A week and a half to 2 weeks after the oil spill, massive forest fires took hold of the region, and we still see forest fires still burning today out of control near the oil spill. And what kind of threat does this pose to local communities if we can't contain local forest fires, or massive forest fires, as a matter of fact, near facilities that are potentially explode, that have exploded from some of these fires, or, you know, by the leaks on the pipelines that we're seeing all across Alberta because of this infrastructure that needs to support the oil and gas. I think, you know, the reason I do this work is because of what's happening in my community. You know, we see a massive oil spill, we see, you know, wildlife and the ecosystems dying, you know, before people's eyes. We see a crisis in the northern part of Alberta because of tar sands development. And, you know, going back home to deal with an oil spill and see how my family was being treated and how my family felt sick and was put, you know, in this threatening position of not even knowing what their rights were, what they could do to protect themselves, was utterly heartbreaking. How many more communities have to be threatened, and how many more communities have to have their health put at risk for this type of development? And who is it really benefiting? It's not going to benefit any of us in the end. What are we leaving to future generations? We're leaving contaminated water and contaminated polluted air and ecosystems that aren't going to be thriving. This type of development doesn't have to happen. We're talking about scraping the bottom of the barrel, you know, producing the dirtiest form of oil. And there are solutions out there. And we need to see a change in this world. And we need to push for renewable energy systems that help communities to actually be self-sufficient and self-sustaining. And we need to shift away from a fossil fuel-based system and push for a renewable energy system that actually can help us transition out of what we are currently facing. Inspiring to see more people caring specifically about their treaty rights, but also how this relates to the general public and how we're all going to be impacted through the desecration of Mother Earth ultimately, which will affect us all. One thing that really shocked me and politicized me as a young person when I came to the city, coming from a small res or community that has no running water, even though billions of dollars actually come out of the traditional territory of the Lubicon Cree, we see, you know, our communities and my family still living in extreme poverty. And it's when I came to the city and went to high school here, I was just shocked to see how many resources that cities have, and cities kind of really benefit from the extraction of communities. And then a lot of the resources go up and it doesn't really trickle down to the communities that actually are first directly impacted, but it does definitely comes to the cities. And so I think that's a huge discrepancy that I saw between the way that people live here in the cities with an abundant amount of resources a lot of the times compared to the way that First Nation communities live, even though that's where the lands and the resources are actually being extracted from. So I think that was a really big learning curve for me as a young person. I think that's really what politicized me to do this work, starting in my late teens and throughout my 20s. So, and then when we saw Bill C-38 come through, that was, I think, the first shocking point. And now with 45, it's just kind of like the nail in the coffin for a lot of people. And I think that's why it's incited so many people. And, you know, I guess the only thing that we have to thank for the Harper government is that it's brought this many people together and standing in solidarity and saying no.
So thank you, everyone, for coming. My name is Bill Morkilgannon, and I'm the Executive Director of Public Interest Alberta. I'm pleased to be co-hosting this media conference this morning with Morningstar Mercredi and other key local activists with the Idle No More movement.
We must stand together, we must band together to form ties to demand progressive change for all of Canada. Idle No More and Bill C-45 is not merely a First Peoples issue, in the same way that Bill C-377 isn't merely a union issue or C-38 isn't an issue only for seniors. The list goes on and on and on. The issues affect all of us, every last Canadian.
And I think all Canadians owe Idle No More a great debt of gratitude for talking about issues that impact us all, talking about environmental protections, talking about democracy.
The Edmonton and District Labour Council stand in solidarity with Idle No More and common causes.
Pense, my name is Melina Lobokan-Masmo, and I'm a member of the Lubicon Cree First Nation.
My name is Mike Kidima, and we're both climate and energy campaigners with Greenpeace Canada.
We are here today to stand in solidarity with Idle No More and the growing number of organizations and First Nations that oppose Harper's atrocious omnibus bills. They are not only an attack on Indigenous rights, but on environmental laws, and are also an attack on the democratic rights of all Canadians. Thank you very much.
On behalf of the tens of thousands of members that we have across the country, we are very pleased to add Greenpeace Canada's name onto this stand of solidarity. We are Idle No More.
Changes to the Water Protection Act reduces the number of lakes and rivers where navigation and federal environmental assessment is required from 32,000 to just 97 lakes, and from 2.25 million to just 62 rivers without any consultation with First Nations or, for that fact, any Canadian. Quite frankly, with 450 pages, I'm unsure that anybody knows the true effect of these bills. And on behalf of our executive and our 45,000 members, we stand in solidarity with Idle No More.
Treaties are the last protection. After Bill C-38, treaties are the last things that stand in the way of this government and their agenda to destroy every last meter and every last drop. So we'll be standing proudly in solidarity with First Nations and with Métis communities and Northern people, and we are happy to build those relationships, because what we're hearing out of Idle No More is to build a nation-to-nation relationship. I don't know if that's going to come from Harper, so I'm going to take that on myself, and I invite everyone else to start organizing in our communities and to start organizing and building those relationships and making it better for ourselves, because we can't wait for them to do it for us.
The Memoria Viva Society of Edmonton, Latin American refugees in diaspora, share common values with their brothers and sisters of Turtle Island. We are here today to declare solidarity, and with them, to be forever Idle No More. As refugees, we are displaced people that have experienced the oppression of colonization and imperialism. With our brothers and sisters, we choose to bring attention to the destruction of Pachamama, Mother Earth, through the continued privatization of natural resources of this territory, whose original peoples have the right to protect and defend. We support our brothers and sisters in their sovereign right to nationhood, to defend their land and assert their culture and language. Idle No More provides an opportunity for all people to rethink social, political, and economic relations to include environmental, spiritual, and communitarian values, as was prophesied by our ancestors in the story of the condor and the eagle. Memoria Viva Society is Idle No More. Thank you.
We always start with a prayer song. It's going to start off in our language. It says, God's kingdom is for me. God created this world for us. This world is for us. That's how the prayer song is.
On the front pages of every single media outlet and in everybody's agenda, because this is important. This is a fight that we all must fight together. We are very proud to be part of Idle No More, and also very proud to be part of Common Causes, because this is a fight that we must all as Canadians engage in, and we cannot no longer just sit by and watch this government do what they've been doing.
So I'm honored to stand, you know, with and besides and alongside First Nations people in this struggle, because you're the original environmentalists here. I'm just catching up. So thank you so much for your work, and I'm honored to be here, and I'm, you know, happy and honored to be part of Idle No More. Thank you.
And I just want to say, I think it's time that we, as the citizens of Canada, step up, and we show that we're not going to let the government do whatever they want. And we're going for Idle No More. So long live Idle No More!
You see, that our forefathers made treaties. It's a peace and friendship. And we need to stand by that. They've done that for a reason.
Thank you. Thanksgiving.
The government is now reviewing the whole water system right now. They've just launched their water conversations. And the problem is that they refuse to change the Fit for system. They've made that clear that they're not going to change that, because all those farmers in southern Alberta who have those senior licenses now have pieces of papers worth millions of dollars, even though they were given those licenses for free. And the oil companies and other big municipalities and what have you, as they grow and as they want to do their development stuff, are going to pay a huge amount of money in order to access that water. The federal bills are saying that not only are they not going to be protecting our rivers and our lakes anymore, they're saying to First Nations that you now have to fall under the jurisdiction of provincial law. And when the First Nations groups came to the provincial government and said, well, what's this going to mean? The province said, you're going to have to apply for licenses like everyone else in order to access water. But your licenses are going to be in the year in which you applied for them, 2013, 2014. In other words, they will be very junior licenses. How are you going to tell a whole community you're being cut off your water because your water license is more junior compared to the oil company down the road? How is that going to happen? But this is backed by legal agreements. It's also backed by international trade agreements. Once we go down that road and they consider those water licenses property that are tradable, then international trade law, the North American Free Trade Agreement, the World Trade Organization kicks in. The market is definitely not the way to go. And that's, we've got this huge fight on our hands. Again, First Nations communities, Fort Chip, completely different scenario. Under treaty, under federal relations, that water shouldn't even be talked about as being licensed through the province. But that's what the federal government is forcing on First Nations, them to be part of the provincial laws, and why it's so important that the principle of first in time, first in right be absolutely applied to First Nations people, because First Nations people were first in time. But that's not what the government thinks, and what it's not putting on the table at this stage. So controlling those water licenses means access, means you control water. And so that's why we're so focused on it is in the public interest. It is up to all of us to set those terms and not just say, oh, the market will decide. Because the market will only decide based on the people who have the deepest pockets, not on what we all need, and we all need water. Maybe we should be saying no, like other provinces and other states, to say fracking is too dangerous and it's a waste of our incredibly precious resource. As long as the government's not valuing it, though, we're putting millions and millions of liters of water every year into the ground, out of the hydrological cycle forever, due to fracking. It's a battle over that, seeing water as something that's part of the public good, as opposed to just something that's going to be controlled by corporations in the future.
Hydraulic fracking threatens an important public resource, which is groundwater. All groundwater is connected to surface water. At this current time in Western Canada, we have not mapped, protected, or monitored our groundwater sources. At the same time that the federal government has gutted and diminished our most important environmental laws for protecting water, period. So the federal government has diminished the Fisheries Act, it has taken apart the Navigable Waters Act, it has taken apart the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act, you name it, one omnibus bill after another. This government has declared open war on resources that belong to ordinary Canadians and is making it easier for corporate Canada, or multinational corporations for that matter, to destroy these resources with impunity and depriving Canadians, First Nations, rural Canadians, you name it, depriving them of the legal recourse to contest this massive giveaway and this massive assault on resources that are essential for community life in this country.
It's really hard to act as an individual. You need a movement. And I think that's what the Idle No More is promising. And I think there's a lot of interest in that movement as a movement to say, you know, government is supposed to be for the people. We are the people. This is what we want. And it's time to listen to the people. And if you don't listen to the people, we'll show you we have some power. And, you know, how that is shown is depends on the groups of people. But, you know, I know there have been roads blocked and a lot of things. If the people are angry, and I think we're getting that way, there's lots of ways you can slow down industry, and then the industry is not going to be happy about that, and then they're going to complain to government, and maybe eventually we'll all figure out how to do things sustainably. So the whole foothills, you know, between the mountains and the prairies and where the cities get their water is going to be fracked. And we don't know what the results of that will be. And I don't think the Alberta public knows that's the plan. Or surely they would be discussing it. Now, one thing that has been monitored very carefully is caribou. You know, relatively speaking, you can always know more, but caribou have been monitored and in the oil sands and throughout Alberta because of all the industrial use. Caribou herds everywhere in Alberta are in steep decline. They haven't, you know, they don't know what to do about it because the only solution really is to limit industrial use, which of course in Alberta is, you just wouldn't even think of it. So in one area, the most suffering herd is the Little Smoky herd in the foothills. And it's at immediate risk of going extinct, so they're killing wolves. That's their solution. And, you know, and recently it was found out that they're leasing the last remaining parts of that habitat to fracking companies. And for decades they've made promises, well, we're going to save some of their habitat. We've got to do this. We've got to do this since the 80s, the early 80s, saying, well, we've got to change our, you know, we've got to save some habitat for these animals or we're going to lose them. They say that and then they don't do it. We have to affect the economics. We have to tell the world, this is what's really happening in Alberta. Our premier may go to Washington and say these things, but if you look into it, this is actually what's happening. If anybody can change the Alberta government, it surely is the Alberta people. Not through the conventional election process, because that doesn't really seem to work properly, but by going out in the streets and saying, you know, I'm putting my body on the line here. What we're doing is not responsible. I'm a responsible person. I think most Albertans would like to think of themselves as responsible. Well, we have to make sure our government is acting in the way we want, not the way industry wants.
Bill 36, it's the Land Stewardship Act. Bill 46, Bill 19, Bill 50, which is replaced by Bill 8, and now Bill 2, that makes one for the government and the oil industry very efficient, one address regulator for it. So all these bills are an infringement on the people that are dependent on that surface of that land. And we have, at the moment, a Department of Environment that recklessly gives permit for water extraction from rivers and aquifer. And C-45 and C-38 that has limited the rights of First Nations peoples' access to water, as it is less protected, and they now have to get licenses, but they come late in the game with these licenses, so they would be the first ones to be revoked when there is a shortage. The whole process will cause way more water being pumped out of the system because of commercial value. And right now, I don't fully exercise my right to withdraw all that water because if I don't need it, I won't pump it up and I won't sell it. But as soon as it has a value, you will find everywhere people that maximize that right to sell. And that collectively will mean way more water withdrawal than what we have now. We need absolutely sustainable processes to be guided and protected in order to have any confidence that down the road we can do what we do today. It is totally irresponsible what government is doing, and it is sacrificing the public interests and definitely the interest of future generations. I mean, we don't even have to go there. Our current generation living on the land will see all the impediments created by recent policies and recent reckless behavior. It has always been our obligation to follow First Nations spirituality in making sure future generations can live as well as we do. And we are modest in that understanding.
I welcome all races of people in this gathering today to help me as we go to our Maker in prayer.
He's Maori from New Zealand. I'd like to welcome Brendan. Hoko for you too.
When any Indigenous resistance movement becomes highly mediated, as Idle No More has, part of the resistance movement must rearticulate itself as a pedagogical practice. So essentially countering misinformation and misrepresentation.
I was asked to speak about treaty. Canadians need to understand how this country was founded, the reasons, and they need to understand they're part of the treaty relationship too, because they have not to this point understood what that is and what that means. And just like us, Indigenous people, they also have a responsibility to understand what that is. It's not just a written document, it's a living spirit.
I don't think we can lose the importance of how Indigenous women are leading this social movement. And, you know, I think the leaders sitting at this table that have done that for Chief Spence, the leaders in Saskatchewan and across Turtle Island and beyond.
Speaking of women, a particular woman, Chief Spence, we're going to be speaking now with Danny Manitowabin and Chief Teresa Spence.
I'm asking everybody to encourage all the chiefs, you know, to really work with the grassroots people and with the Idol movement. Because the Idol movement really speaks to everybody, including human citizens and outside our world there.
My name is Wabanaquit, which means white cloud or gray cloud in the Shinabamwin. When I moved to Winnipeg, they shortened that to Wab. Nobody wanted to learn how to say Wabanaquit. There's one thing basically I wanted to say to you guys today, which is that life is hard. This fight is easy. So thanks for coming out. I'll see you guys later. No. For the people who have given so much to Idle No More over these past months and weeks, I kind of wanted to talk to you guys about the political level. So if there's two actions at work in Idle No More, there's one, which is the political level, which I would say is the external focus. How are we going to relate with the different levels of government, and how are we going to relate with other Canadians? And then there's the internal. How are we going to do better for ourselves? So I'll talk about the external political thing first. I think we've proven that we have the potential for a very strong ground game when we mobilized 10,000 people on Ottawa on January 11th. When here in Edmonton, you guys mobilized close to 2,000 on December 10th. In Winnipeg, every few weeks, you know, thousands of people come out and do a round dance or a rally at the legislative building. But maybe there's an event going on where we want to show either solidarity in favor of it or opposition to it, and then we can bring out hundreds, if not thousands, of people to those type of events. I'm not a politician, and I don't know very much about politics. Perhaps we need to have a conversation with the Assembly of First Nations and make sure that they hear the voices that are being raised within Idle No More. One, how do we organize and bring people out? And then two, who is going to be the emissary? Who will be the people that we would like the federal government to deal with, to answer our concerns, to assuage the things that we are raising here? So that's politics. You know, that's easy. For me, the hard part is within our communities. You know, yesterday I was in Laxul First Nation in Northern Ontario, and I was talking to some young people there, and a young man came up to me, and it was just, you know, the usual, like, hey, how's it going, and this and that, and can you take a photo, you know, whatever. But then very casually, nonchalantly, he told me, you know, I've been thinking of killing myself lately. I've been thinking of committing suicide. And that's where it gets hard, because what am I supposed to tell him? Oh, don't commit suicide, because we're getting action on comprehensive claims. You know? No, don't do it, because, you know, we're working on our indigenous governance systems. You know? Don't kill yourself. There's investments being made in our community for more jobs. But to me, that is the challenge. I Don't Know More has marched our culture and our cause back into the national collective conscience, which is a beautiful thing. It has energized so many people from coast to coast to coast, those people in the remote communities that I mentioned earlier, people in the inner cities across Western Canada, academics, physicians, business people, homeless people. Yet what do we do with that? Do we say, oh, well, we'll try again next time? Do we say, well, we did what we could, I guess it's back to just collecting a paycheck? No. We've come too far this time to turn back now. We owe it to our relatives who we have lost in so many painful ways, to addiction, to those other things that I don't even want to mention. We owe it to them to make sure that the change we seek today is accomplished. But how do we make that happen? How can we change the life for that young man in Laxul? How can we change it for the brother in the bar right now? How do we change it for the young sister on the streets? We are creatures of habit. We are creatures of habit. And somehow we have to change those habits and make them more healthy. Somehow we have to awaken within our communities the strong warrior spirit. So what I did, and I think it might be helpful for some people, is that I wrote out a declaration outlining the principles and the values that I live my life by, and I think are healthy values to live your life by. And I'm going to read them to you, and it's not that I'm saying that this is how you should live, but rather it's a suggestion for an exercise you might go through yourself. When I was young, the first thing we were taught is never to go into someone else's territory and try and tell them how to do things. So it's with humility that I'm going to read this to you guys. So this is the declaration I came up with, and I've got copies up here if you guys want to review it and take a look at it. We are all related. We should treat everyone as though they are our brothers and sisters, unless they are our boyfriend or girlfriend. Then that would be weird. We are citizens of the world who deserve to be happy and are free to make the most of our lives, so long as we don't hurt anyone else. We care enough to give back, both to the indigenous communities we come from and to others in need. We exercise and eat well so we can feel good. We have a right to healthy food and clean water. We resolve to continue learning all our lives through high school credits, post-secondary courses, indigenous languages, and traditional knowledge. We are never alone. When lonely, we reach out to our community. When our friends in need reach out to us, we do what we can to help them as long as we stay safe. We want to live up to our full potential, keeping free of chemicals and other things that slow us down, like cigarettes, drugs, and alcoholism. We work hard every day, both to provide for our families and to gain a sense of pride in a job well done. We promise never to raise a hand against the ones we love. We must never hit a girlfriend, boyfriend, parent, or child. When we choose to become parents, we will care greatly for our children. We also support the children we know who have lost their parents, all our relations. So with that, I will say once again, life is hard. This fight is easy.
Canadian public in general is more open to think through some of these issues. And so I think the dialogue that is happening and is going to continue to happen is amazing.
It's amazing that four people started this whole movement. Like, an elder told me the other day, they're like, women are very powerful. See, if it wasn't for the woman, there wouldn't be the Métis population. You think about that.
If I've done anything in life, it's been because of women lifting me up. From a young age, my mom, for, professional career, a lot of my, supporters and stuff have always been females.
Don't be scared of being yourself and going against the colonial mindset of dominance. Embrace your genuine self of love and compassion. And follow your heart.
Idle No More has brought a lot of attention also to the economy, as well as the environment. And there's some interrelationships there, of course, that we understand. And there has not been enough, there's been too much desecration of Mother Earth and everything that Creator provides for us to see that we live to see another day. Dorothy MacDonald, who was the first Treaty Indian chief in Canada, never mind Alberta, Canada, real fighter. Dorothy, incidentally, was one of the only people from the private sector to ever take a multinational corporate oil company to court for pollution and win her case. that was beautiful. That was absolutely beautiful.
My community, Fort Chipewyan, is the oldest settlement in Alberta. It is also ground zero for industrial terrorism. Deaths are more common than not, and many forms of rare cancer and disease continue to plague the people.
Kayla Louise Galen Cardinal, 12 years old.
Tiara Woodward, 10 years old.
Daryl Mercedes Cardinal, 10.
Kayla Nella Voyager, I am 9.
Evangeline Cardinal,
9. Catherine Powder, 12 years old.
Clifton Powder, I am 11.
Vitalia Letwood, 12 years old.
Jasmine Winslet, 9 years old.
Jessica Raven Montana,
Renee Marcel, 12 years old.
Samuel Lamb, 12 years old.
Come to Fort Chip because it's a fun place to play.
I lived here since I was one.
My mom and dad, they go hunting, pick berries, they check nets, and they make dry fish. Yeah, I made dry fish before. You cut the fish open, you lay them down, and then you slice it like that, and then you hang them up. They find fish with funny things because the lake is polluted with all different stuff.
My grandma used to tell me that they used to just go running down to the lake with a cup and then they used to drink the water. But no, can't even do that.
Some pollution from St. Croix flowing down the river and it starts coming here and then our water turns yellow.
Your toenails and fingernails will go yellowish-orange.
I like swimming, but not here. Cause you just die.
Yeah, because sometimes in summer there's nothing to pretty much do when you can't go swimming.
You get cancer and a bunch of stuff on your body.
What swimmer is it?
It's a whole bunch of red bumps or spots you get on your legs and arms and everywhere.
Grant Carter was my cousin from my aunt.
the oil sands exist because they needed money.
Money.
They just try to make money.
Get the money, then leave.
I think the government's going along with it because he has a lot of money coming in and doesn't really care about the planet or the Earth.
Because if they don't listen, pretty soon Fort Chip will just become another tailing pond.
I was in a little group of protesting for the oil sands to get shut down.
We made some signs. I think it was Stop Sinkhood, because we don't want our lake to look like this for our children.
I don't know why the government goes along with it, because it's not right. We should have a voice. Our voice should be heard.
When I protest, it's like everything evolves with each other and like helps each other. It kind of makes me feel like happy and in power.
I'm pretty sure us kids can make a difference.
Water is life for me.
We need to unify as a human race in defense of water, life, for generations yet to come.
Gave my heart and never let me have it back again. You can take the flag off of my front porch and burn it down to ashes in the wind. You can take away the blue in my sky. You can even take my life, but not without a fight. Of mine. But I'll always have my hope. No, I'll never let it go. Not without a fight. Yeah, not without a fight. Oh, I may lose it all. Where I stand, I may fall. You might take everything I have. Not without a fight. No. Take everything I have.